friends. Good to be with you again today as we examine the Gospel according to John. Some parts of John are difficult because it's easy to speak and to relate to what we call narrative passages, sections that talk about Jesus and what he did and so on. It's a little harder dealing with these passages of John, which are sort of philosophical in the sense that they deal with spiritual things, and yet they're absolutely vital because this is what makes John unique, is exactly this, his emphasis on these spiritual aspects of Jesus and of who Jesus is. So let's ask the Lord to help us as we study today. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you especially for John, who wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in a way which is different to Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And Lord, that he reveals the spiritual and philosophical, if you will, dimensions of who Jesus is. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us today. Help me to bring these things across in a way that is relatable and understandable, but above all, Lord, that your Spirit would write within our hearts the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, make these things real to us. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's read again from John's Gospel, and we'll just read the first 13 verses. And I'm hoping to go a little faster today and deal with a few more verses up to verse 11. But let's read from verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And so John begins and he introduces Jesus as the Word. He introduces him as life, and he introduces him as the light. And so now the picture shifts a little bit to John the Baptist. So if we then go to verse 6, there was a man sent from God, whose name was John. Why does it introduce John in this way? Remember, Luke, for example, goes into the history of John's parents, the conception of John, and eventually his birth and his naming and so on. John the Apostle, remember there's two Johns here. John the Apostle, or John the Beloved, who is writing this book, even though his name does not appear anywhere in the book. He simply refers to himself, we believe, as the one whom Jesus loved. But his own name, he does not refer to himself at all. But we understand this is John who's writing, John the Beloved or John the Apostle, but there's also John the Baptist. Sometimes get these two a little bit mixed up, but particularly in some of these passages as we get further down chapter 1, you'll see there are sections where we're not sure whether it's John speaking, Jesus speaking, whether it's but we'll pass it out and we'll figure out who's who. So he introduces John, and he says there was a man sent from God whose name was John. So he emphasizes John's credentials, and we'll see in the next verse why this is important. So he's reminding us John was not a false prophet. John was not a man who sent himself, but John was sent from God. And from Luke, we know the details, how that his birth was prophesied, and that he was specific to be this specifically this voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. He was sent to prepare the way of Jesus. But John, the author of the book here, is not bringing that emphasis. He is bringing a different emphasis, which I'm going to come to in the next verse. But so he establishes John the Baptist's credentials. He is sent from God. Most people that were believers would not have a problem with that. But remember that John is not just writing to believers. He's writing to unbelievers, particularly to Greek unbelievers. And he is saying John was sent from God, and his name was John. And of course, there's a whole story on that. He didn't get his father's name. The angel said to his father, Zacharias, that his name was to be John, not according to the family tradition. So the next verse tells us that he came for a witness. So we know from the other Gospels that part of his ministry or his calling was to prepare the way of the Lord. And his message is one of repentance. And he introduces Jesus. Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, further down in the chapter. Having done that, he fades off the scene. So his one very important ministry was to introduce Jesus. But John, the beloved, is now emphasizing another aspect of John's ministry, or John's function. And that is that he came for a witness. He came for a witness to bear witness of the light that all through him might believe. So he prepares the way for Jesus. He prepares the hearts of people to receive the gospel. But he is also a witness, and he is a witness to Jesus. And this applies in two ways. First of all, as he points out to who Jesus is, he is preparing the audience, the people who were really following him, his disciples, in the sense there was an inner circle and an outer circle. He's preparing them to receive Jesus. But there is another aspect now that John the Beloved is referring to, and that is that John testifies, remember, a witness testifies that Jesus is indeed the Messiah. He is the Christ. And this is a theme that's going to develop as we go right through the book. So John the Beloved is going to call a whole bunch, about seven different witnesses, who all attest to who Jesus is. In other words, John the Beloved is not saying, is saying to us, Jesus didn't just come on the scene and say, hey, here I am the Messiah. Remember, many others had tried that trick before, and many others have tried since then. And even in these days, there are those who come and who say, I am the last prophet, I am Jesus, and so on. It's easy to make that claim. But the only way on which you can make that claim is if you are able to prove your claim. And the way to prove your claim is through witnesses. Remember, the Old Testament established this principle that by two or three witnesses, every word will be established. So you can't condemn a man without witnesses. And so Jesus and his claim to being the anointed one, God in the flesh, is corroborated by and proven by eyewitnesses. Not just witnesses, but eyewitnesses. And John is the first of these eyewitnesses. And so see what the writer is saying. He's first of all saying John was a man sent from God. He wasn't. Remember, they brought witnesses to Jesus' trial before his crucifixion. And they were scallywags. They were liars, just guys off the street who would say anything for a buck. John is not that. John was sent by God. And so his witness is true because he is sent by God. And so we can trust who John says Jesus is. John the Baptist says who Jesus is. So he came as a witness to bear witness of the light. So the author has introduced this idea of Jesus being the light. He is now saying that he is bearing witness to the light. And for what purpose? So that Jesus can run around and say, I am the light. And indeed he did say, I am the light of the world. But is that the point? For us, that's often the point. Why do we want people to know who we are? So that we can have our ego stroked, so that we can be elevated, so we can boast in who we are. Jesus is not interested in that, and neither is John the Baptist. They're interested in the salvation of souls. And so he bears witness of the light that all through him might believe. Now you notice on the screen that the him there is lowercase. In other words, the translators are suggesting that it is through John the Baptist's witness that people would believe. I'm not sure that that's right. I tend to think that this is referring to Jesus, that through Jesus we might believe on Jesus. But it would not be wrong to say this is John the Baptist, that through John we would believe on Jesus, because John witnessed to who Jesus is. And certainly there were some of the disciples who followed John, who used to follow John the Baptist, and then began to follow Jesus because of John's testimony. But when it says that all through him might believe, I tend to believe that this is speaking about Jesus. Now, I want you to see here that he is introducing now this idea of believing. So he's introduced a few ideas already that we're going to find right through the book. The idea of light, the idea of life, now the idea of witness. This is going to come back again and again. And now believing. Now, we need to remember then that there are two Greek words here that are important. Pistis is the noun. Pistis means faith as a noun. This is pistio, which is not a noun, but it speaks about a doing. There was a false teacher, but he did touch on some truth when he introduced the idea of a new word called faithing, believing. And so it's not just having faith, it's believing on Jesus for the purpose of salvation. We'll come to that in more detail in the next few verses. But believing who Jesus is, it's no good saying, well, I believe in Jesus, but I don't believe who he is. I don't believe that he is the Christ, he is the Messiah. I don't believe that he is God in the flesh. I don't believe that he really became a man. He's just an apparition. These were all ideas that John is writing against. No, we believe, and it is a life-changing faith. In fact, the word suggests an ongoing believing. We'll come back to that again, because this idea is going to come back several times. So the purpose of it all is that we might come to faith, that we may come to believe who Jesus is, that he is. And John is going to give us many portraits of Jesus, but primarily that he is God and that he is flesh, that he came in the flesh. And of course, to the Greeks that in John's day, this idea that God could become flesh was abhorrent. There was no way that God could touch filthy flesh, but Jesus indeed became flesh for us. He became a man just like us. And of course, the book of Hebrews goes into tremendous detail dealing with this. So he came as a witness, and he bears witness to the light that through him all might believe, or that all through him might believe. The whole purpose of it is faith. The whole purpose of my preaching, the whole purpose of this video, is that you will believe. Not just that you will believe for salvation, but that you will believe God for his word, that you will believe the comforts that come from God's word, that you will believe the threats, if I can call it that, the warnings, that if we don't fix our lives, if we don't do the things we should be doing, there are consequences to those things. That we will believe when Jesus says that there is an eternal flame, that we will believe that he says, in my Father's house are many mansions. You see, you can't say, I believe that Jesus is this, but I don't believe the rest of him. You have to take him as a package deal. And when he promises heaven, he promises hell, and you have to take both of those together. When he promises eternal life and eternal damnation, you have to take those together. When he speaks about the judgment and the wrath of God, and when he speaks about the grace and the mercy of God, we have to take these together. We have to believe in him and in all that he comprises, all that he is, all that he promises, all that he teaches, so that we would come to a point of believing. Now, verse 8 says, he was not that light. John was not the light. Now, why does he say this? It seems, we're not exactly sure, but it seems that there were many who, or some, let's not say many, but there were some who believed that John was the Messiah. And there are hints of this in the Gospels. And then you remember that in Acts, Paul comes to Ephesus, and he finds believers there, and he says, what baptism are you? And they said, well, John's baptism. So it seems that they were following John to some extent. And so it's quite possible that here he's addressing the question that John is not the Messiah. And John himself points out that I'm not even worthy to untie his shoelaces. So John was not the light, but he was sent to bear witness of that light. So here's the second time that he uses this word witness. And as I said, the word is going to appear many more times as we go through the gospel. Now in verse 9, that was the true light that gives light to every man coming into the world. The first word I emphasize today is pisteo, believing. Here we have another word which John uses many times, and it is the word world. Let's first look at the beginning of the verse then. So let's just go back. He was not the light, verse 8, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. And so Jesus is the true light. Now, when it says the true light, it can mean two things. The first is that there could be a false light. Remember that the devil himself presents himself as an angel of light. No, that is a false light. And of course, there are many lights in this world. There are many people who are saying, we have the light. The Buddhists believe they have the light. The Hindus believe they have the light. And so the list goes on. But there's only one true light. All of those other lights are false lights. And you have to get the right light. You have to follow the right light. Remember the wise men who came to Jesus when after he was born, and they followed a star. Now, they couldn't follow any star. They had to follow the right star that would lead them to Bethlehem. And so it is important for us to recognize that there are many who claim to have light, and there are many who promise us light, but there's only one true light. But more specifically, what John is speaking about here is the true as the fulfillment of the shadows and the types of the Old Testament. And this idea is going to come out further again. Remember, Jesus speaks to the woman at the well, and he says that the worshippers will worship in spirit and in truth. They worshipped in shadows and types. They worshipped in physical things in the Old Testament, but the true worshippers worship the reality. And so this is the real light. And so again, there was light in the Old Testament. The prophets presented light. There was the light that God made in creation. These were all things that point to Jesus. If you look at the sun, the S-U-N, it should point you to the S-O-N, the sun. These are all parts of the revelation, if you will, of who Jesus is. But at the end of the day, he is the fulfillment of all of those prophecies. The people who sat in a dark place, remember Isaiah chapter 9, have seen a great light. And so the prophets brought light. There was the light of God in his glory revealed in the tabernacle and on Mount Sinai. And at different times, God reveals himself in light in the Old Testament. But Jesus is the fulfillment. He is the reality of which those things are simply shadows. In the same way as the sacrifices in the Old Testament were not the real or the true sacrifice. Jesus is the true sacrifice, the real sacrifice that those all spoke of. And so any reference on the many references in the Old Testament referencing light, they are all pointing to the true light, the real light, the fulfillment of the light in Jesus Christ. So he is the reality. He is the fulfillment. Now we come to a very important part of this passage. He is the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. Now just think of what he's saying. He is the true light, and he gives light to every man. So sisters are excluded. No, every person. Now think about what he's saying. He's saying everyone who is born, everyone coming into the world, has light because God has given them light. Now, it doesn't mean they're saved. I think we understand that. Doesn't mean they're saved, but they have light. They have sufficient light to point them to Jesus. And so when people say, well, what about people living in the jungle who've never heard the gospel? According to John, everyone who is born has light. They may not have the full light. They may not have full revelation of who Jesus is, but they have sufficient light. And I believe it's in the form of conscience that tells them that there is a God, there is a creator, and that if they follow that light, the same way as the wise men followed the light of the star, they eventually ended up with Jesus. If you follow the light from when you first born, if you follow the light that God has placed within your heart, it will eventually lead you to Jesus. Doesn't matter where you are. Doesn't matter what culture or what tradition you grow up in. But we know the problem. Men did not like the light. They suppressed the light because their deeds were evil. So what does this tell me? It tells me that nobody has an excuse. There is no one who can say, well, I did not know. Because John testifies, John the author, the beloved, testifies that Jesus gives light to everyone who is coming into the world. No one is born without an awareness of God, without a God component, if you will, without enough revelation that there is something someone out there that they need to seek and that they need to follow. And as I said, your response can be one of two things. And the next few verses are going to deal with that. You can either reject the light or you can receive the light. Verse 12, which we'll do next week, as many as received him, received the light. Remember that that as we are faithful in the little, much is given. And as we are faithful in nurturing that little flame of light that God gives us at our birth, it will eventually blossom into a full-blown understanding of who Jesus is. But if you suppress that light, as Paul speaks about in Romans chapter 1, they suppressed the truth. They didn't want to know the truth, and so they pressed it under. God's judgment comes upon them, and God's judgment is just because they had the light, but they rejected that light. So he gives light to every man who comes into the world. Now, he was in the world. Sorry, let's go back. I forgot to mention. So this is the first time John uses the word world. Here, the Greek word is cosmos, which I think we know pretty well. And John uses this word 78 times. 78 times. When you compare that to Matthew's 8 times and Mark's 3 times and Luke's 3 times, so that is 14 times in the other 3 Gospels, John uses it 78 times. So this is an important concept, the world, the same way as faith. John uses the word faith or pistio, believing. John uses that word almost 100 times. That is 3 times more than Matthew, Mark, and Luke together. So you can see that these are very important concepts, which are going to be developed in John's discourses as he goes through the book, and that we need to pay attention to. So he was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. Now here, the word world simply means into this world, into this universe, on this planet. But now he says he was in the world, and the world was made through him. So Jesus came, and he became a man. He came down to earth. The Word became flesh, we'll see a bit further down in this chapter, and dwelt among us. So he was in the world. He wasn't a distant God. He didn't remain far from us. Remember, in the first session, we spoke about the Logos, and in the Logos, we spoke about the fact that God is a revealing God, that he is a communicating God, that he wants to show himself to us. And so he comes on human form. We saw him. And John's going to speak about this later on and say that we've handled him, we've touched him, the Word of life. So he became a human being that they could see at that time. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, emphasizing what he said in verses 1 and 3, that he made the world. So not only did he come into the world, but he made the world. And the world did not know him. The world did not know him. Now remember that sometimes when John uses the word cosmos, it's meaning the universe. When it says the world was made through him, obviously meaning the planet. But then when he says, and the world did not know him, it doesn't mean the planet didn't know him, but that the people of the world, particularly the unbelievers, the evil aspects of this world, and we'll speak more about cosmos as we go along, but that the people of the world did not know him. In other words, they did not recognize him. He was there, but they didn't know who he was. You remember the Pharisees. Jesus reveals himself to them. He has all of these witnesses that John's going to speak about, particularly the signs that proved who he was. The Pharisees saw the signs. They heard the words Jesus speak. They knew the prophecies and how that Jesus had fulfilled those prophecies in his birth. And yet when he stood before them, they said he has a devil. They didn't know him. Because they didn't want to know him, because they were suppressing the truth, because their deeds were evil. Now here's a tremendous warning to us, because it is easy for him to be in us, or not in us in the sense of salvation, but to be among us, for us to have his word. You're hearing his word today. And yet at the same time, you can choose to reject his word. You can choose to reject his claims. You can choose to reject who he is. And so he was in the world, and the world was made through him. So the world was his handiwork. And the world didn't even recognize its creator. Isn't that true of most people in the world today? God made them. He made the universe. He made the world. And yet they don't know him. They don't recognize who he is. In fact, they deny that he even exists. And now here comes probably the hardest part of this passage. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Now, when he says he came to his own, John uses the same phrase when Jesus, remember, when Jesus is on the cross, he says to John, take care of Mary. And it says that John took Mary to his own house. That's the same word, his own. So his own house simply means, or does not just mean his property, but it does mean that. So he came to his own property. The world is his property. He made it. He owns it. Every blade of grass, the cattle on 1,000 hills, the wealth in every mine. It's all his. And yet that which is his, the people are his, because he made us. We are the workmanship of his hands. And so we are his. We belong to him. He can dispose of us if he wishes. But it's more than just possession. It's also kinship. And so his own people. So he's particularly speaking about Israel. Jesus didn't come to England, even though some claim he did. Jesus came to Israel, the people who were supposed to be the people of God, supposed to be his people. Remember, from the very beginning, God speaks to Israel. And he says, you will be my people. I'll be your God. They were his. So he comes to his possession. He comes to his kins, his people. And his own did not receive him. And so one of the themes also, remember, we've seen a lot of themes developing in John now. Here's one of the other themes, is that of rejection. And so one of the things you're going to see right through John is the rejection of Jesus. And so Jesus is rejected by his own. I once heard a story, and I'm not sure, I don't know if it is true, but it does illustrate the point. Apparently, during the Great Depression here in America, a very poor family had a son, and they really wanted the best for this boy. And when he became of age, they had scrimped and saved, and they put money together to send him away to college. And the boy went off to the great city, and he went to university. About a year or so later, the parents desperately wanted to see their son. And so they saved again for a long time. and eventually had enough money to travel to the city, to the university, to go and see their son. And when they came to find him where he was, together with some of his friends, he acted like he didn't know them. And his father said, "But I'm your father." And the young man said, "I don't know who you are." Obviously, he was ashamed of his parents because they were poor. And he had become somewhat amongst his friends and learnt a few things. But can you imagine the pain of those parents rejected by their own son? And yet, we have done worse to Jesus. We are not just his children. We are his. He made us. And yet we reject him. And we don't receive him. And of course, it's easy for us to point to Israel and say, well, they were the ones who said, "Crucify him, crucify him. Give us Barabbas." Isn't that where this rejection of Jesus reaches its crescendo? Yeah, I guess it is. But even as Gentiles, we have done no better. We've rejected him, and the world continues to reject him. And we say, well, it's the world. No, the church also rejects him. Remember, right at the very end, it's the same John who then writes the words of Jesus as he writes to the seven churches. And he writes to the church of Laodicea. And he says, "I stand at the door and I'm knocking." The church had locked Jesus out, pushed him out, because they said, "We're rich and increased with goods. We have need of nothing. We don't need Jesus." And folk, there are people, and there are churches, many churches today, who have no room for Jesus. The same way as they had no room for him in the inn, they have no room for him in their churches anymore, because they have their programs, they have their marketing, they have their worship, they have all of the stuff that they do, and they're making good money, and they have crowds following them. And Jesus is just one who comes and upsets the money tables. And they have pushed him out. The preacher has become more important than Jesus. The ceremony has become more, the building has become more important. Everything has become more important. In some cases, even the doctrine has become more important. Came to his own. And I wonder if Jesus comes today, and he can come, and he is going to come very soon, and he can come today. How many churches will welcome him? Or will they also reject him? I believe many will. See, because he upsets people's programs. He makes certain demands because we are his. Not only has he made us, but he has bought us with a price. And I wonder today whether you're not rejecting Jesus in one way or the other. You say, well, I'm not totally rejecting him. Yeah, there were times, and there were those in Jesus' time who said he's a great prophet. But they rejected his claim that he was God and therefore required their allegiance. And yeah, maybe you accept Jesus' teaching, maybe you accept his love, maybe you accept his ministry in your life, his comfort, maybe you even accept that he'll give you heaven. But have you really received who he is? You see, it's all or nothing. Jesus is Lord of all, or he is not Lord at all. Yep, they were happy to have another preacher. They were happy to listen to another prophet. But they didn't want anyone who would take their place of seniority in the hearts of the people. Where is Jesus today? Do you worship him and him alone? Do you receive him for all that he is? I'm going to talk more about this next week. Do you reject some aspects of Jesus' claims on your life? You're His. And the fact that you're listening to this message today probably means that you think that you're a Christian, and you probably are. So you're His. He came to His own, but His own did not receive Him. Are you receiving Jesus today? Are you giving Him access into every area of your life? Are you giving Him access to your pain and your sorrow? Are you giving Him access to your pride and your arrogance? Are you giving Him access to those deep secrets in your heart? Or are you only taking out of Him what you can get? It's all or nothing. He laid it all on the altar at that cross for us. And He's asking you to receive Him in totality, everything that He is, everything that He claims, everything that He commands, everything that He asks. He came to His own, and His own received Him not. Father, I pray that You'd help us to understand. Lord, those who lived at that time were fully justified in their own minds to reject Jesus and to reject His claims. And Lord, I know that there are many today who are just blithely continuing to live their lives as though Jesus has made no claims, as if Jesus is nothing. Pray, Lord, that there may not be one who's watching this message who would not receive Jesus, but Lord, that we will receive Him not just as our Savior, but as our Lord and as our Master and as our King and as our God, that we would receive Him for all that He is. Lord, I do pray if there are those who may be watching who've never received Jesus as their Savior, I pray that today they may claim, may submit to Him in that respect and would accept Him, receive Him, and say, "Yes, Lord, I believe." He came that we might believe, and that in believing we might be saved. Help us, we pray, Lord. Reveal Jesus to us more and more. I ask it in His precious name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.